Good afternoon, everyone. Still alive? I hope so. Okay, so today I'm Imre. I'm senior software engineer in Traveloka, we are working in core data platform team, in data team. And then today I'm going to tell you our journey in migrating our monolithic app in Java into Golang and how we use GraphQL to improve several stuff like security and then usability and that kind of stuff. So before that, actually my lead already speak about Traveloka. So Traveloka is a technology company. Right now we are trying to empower discovery for our customer. Previously, we were trying to enabling mobility by help people to move from one point to another point. But after that, when they already in one point or in one location, we are going to help them to discover what they really interested in. And that's what Traveloka is about. And then we have variety type of products. We started from flight and then hotel and so on until right now. Recently, we released the culinary and attraction and activities product. And I'm going to tell a bit about Traveloka Core Data Platform, the team that I'm working on, what it really does. So Core Data Platform, or we call CDP, basically helps the other internal microservice in Traveloka to provide data. So imagine that flight team needs data about hotel, or flight team need data about the other type of product. So they are going to go to data team to ask that data, and we are going to provide them with using API and that kind of stuff. And this is the old architecture that we have. We have the ETL pipeline. We crunch data from BigQuery, cloud storage, PubSub by using Dataflow, and we put everything into Bigtable. And then from Bigtable, we have monolith Java app, basically, which pull the data and serve the data through a RESTful API. And we have cloud endpoints in here to secure the API and that kind of stuff. And then the data will be accessed by Traveloka backend service. And this is small information, a bit information about our monolith Java app. It's a RESTful API. And then it's really easy to deploy because we only need to deploy one Docker file to Kubernetes cluster. And the problem with Java, it takes considerable amount of memory. So if the application does nothing, it will take about 800 megabytes, which is very crazy. And then another problem that we have with RESTful API that we have is for a single API call, we have to expose so many data. Imagine that if they are calling endpoints less users, and we need to return everything, the first name, last name, address, and so on. And we don't really want to do that because we want to protect the data to the client or to the user that really have access into it. And how are we going to solve it? I'm going to tell you later. And this is our journey in adapting Golang and GraphQL. So the way we learn about Golang is by doing pair programming. So it helps us to learn faster because we don't have much time to learn about Golang, but we have to really focus on developing the application. So this is the timeline. We started using Golang in Q3 2018 last year, and then we started by using one POC. We created one gRPC server by using Golang and gRPC. And after that, in the next quarter, we are trying to separate our monolith app into smaller services, and then we use GraphQL as a data gateway. And this year, we are doing improvement, and then we are still developing several new features and new services. Oh, by the way, we are engineering team with four people in it, and plus one tech lead. And then this is the problem statement. We want to restrict the access data up to field level. So if usually what people does when they have data, they're going to protect the endpoint by using some kind of authorization. But we don't really want to do that now. We want to protect the data up to the field level. So imagine that one single endpoint return 5 fields. We want to give specific permission to every fields within that result. How are we going to do that? This is the example. So this is slash users. The typically JSON response, this is not what we have. This is just example. We have to return everything, but turns out the client doesn't really want to get all of them. Maybe they only want to get email, phone, and the ID, and they don't really care about the other stuff. And this is how we solve it. We are using GraphQL. So GraphQL is query language, but I don't like to say that. I like get only the pieces of data that you care about. So what you see is what you get. What you ask is what you get. So this is the schema of GraphQL. Before you start working with GraphQL, you have to define the schema first. So you must have query. And it's in this example, I have query called hero, and it will accept a name and return a character. And in here, in the character, we have name, friends, and alias. And then how to get the data. So if you see here, we only need to specify which data that we really care about. This is the hero. This is the query. And this query means, give me the name of this hero. And then give me his friends or her friends. And give me the name of his or her friends. As you can see here, for a character, we actually have name, friends, and alias. But in this situation, I only requesting for its name in here, and name and friends. So you will get the result. You get the hero and its name, and you get the friend, the friends, and her or his name. In this situation, I have two friends, Luke Skywalker and Han Solo. And I only get the name. And another cool thing that I really like from GraphQL is you can parameterize the query. If you see here, if we want to have a parameter for hero, we can basically do something like this. You specify that, give me the hero with this name, and give me the hero, the friends of that hero, which are male. So I can specify the filter up to one particular level of data. In this situation, I try to filter their parents, and in this situation, I try to filter its friends by using its gender. So what I got the hero, I got the name, and I got all of the male friends of this R2D2. And one cool thing, another cool thing, you can basically run the same query, two same query in one single call by using query alias. So in here, we have two call to query for hero. This is hero and this is hero. In this first one, you're requesting for name, friends, and the friend's name. But in the other situation, you're only requesting for the name. And for each result, you can specify alias. So the first hero will be RDD2. And as you can see here in the result, it will directly change the JSON into RDD2. And you got exactly the same as before. And here, the alias is Luke. And then you got Luke as the JSON field key. And there are so many other interesting things in GraphQL. There are fragments, directive, enum, enum, mutation, subscription, and so on. If you want, you can learn it directly from the documentation. So this is the new architecture that we have. All of the ETL pipeline still stays the same. We have BigQuery and cloud storage pops up, and we crunch the data from Dataflow, and then we put the data into Bigtable. Give me a moment. And as you can see here, previously we have one single monolith Java app. And now we're trying to separate it into several smaller services, which separate it by its domain. So if you see here, we have flight service right now, hotel service, and payment services. So all of the data related to flight data will go into flight service, and all of the data related to payment will go to a specific service. And other than that, we also have some supporting services, basically, which will help us to do something like permission check. In this case, I have ACL service, access control list. And in the end, I have GraphQL gateway, which basically will pull the data from the internal microservices and return it back to the customer or the clients. And everything that we have in here are deployed in Kubernetes and Istio. And we also use several monitoring tools like Grafana, Jaeger, and some monitoring tools for Google Cloud Platform. And this is a simple mesh that we have. We have GraphQL. GraphQL will talk to flight service and hotel services to get the data. And then the communication between the services are using gRPC. And then flight service in the background will also try to communicate with access control list, or even GraphQL will try to do the same thing directly to access control list. And yeah, that's all. The way we separate it, as I mentioned before, we are using the data domain. So flight service contain the flight data, and hotel service and contain hotel data, and so on. And as you can see here, the interesting thing is we are using gRPC And we are also using Go Micro as our microservices framework. And then to help us secure the inter-service communication, we are using Istio MTLS secure communication. So there are so many good things that you can get from the Istio. There are three important stuff. The first one is observability. So basically, you can monitor what happened within you can see or monitor what happened with the service within the mesh or within the cluster. And like you can get the latency, the number of requests, and so on. And then you can also get security benefit. So traditionally what people does when they want to secure the inter-service communication is they're going to install TLS in every services. But if we are using Istio, we don't need to do that because Istio control plane will try to generate the certificate that will be used by the service within the service mesh. And we also have really nice feature like traffic management, like circuit breaker, timeout, and retry. So basically, you don't need to have code for retry, for timeout inside your code. Everything will be handled by the Istio. So what you really need to focus on your app is about the business logic or what your app really needs to do. And this is the GraphQL. I'm going to talk specifically about the GraphQL server implementation. So we are using GQL again. This is open source project created by 99 Design. You can see it on GitHub. There are three important benefits that we can get from this framework. The first one is its schema first. So you define the schema, and then after that, you focus working on the API. And then it's type safe. You will never see map string empty interface anywhere in the code because it already has structs specifically built in for you. And then it also has something like code generator. So once you define the schema, the GQL again will generate a lot of boring bits so you can focus on your app immediately. So this is the comparison between GQL again with the others GraphQL server in Go. As you can see here, there are so many features that GQL again has, but not for the others framework like Gophers, GraphQL Go, or even Thunder. So this is the sample that I want to show it to you. This is not exactly what we have, but it might help you to understand how we use GraphQL in Traveloka. So we have a query in here, and we have a customer. You can query it by using profile ID, and then it will return the customer. But as you can see here, you can also query for specific information for that particular customer. In this case, you can query for the flag issued for that customer by specifying the start time and time and the number of issuance that you want. And you can also ask the hotel issued for that customer. And I'm not going to explain more about hotel, but I will use flag as an example. So this is the flag will have information about booking ID, booking at, issued at, depart from origin at, and so on. And when you run GQL again, based on this schema, it will generate everything for you, including the models if you don't have custom model. You see here, we already have flag in here, the schema, GraphQL schema, and then it will generate the Go code for that models. So it will have booking ID in string, booking at timestamp, and it will also have something like the tag for the data. And it will also generate the GraphQL related code like HTTP handler and the data handler. The data handler that I'm going to show you next is the one thing that we need to implement by ourselves. So if you see it here before, we have flag. We have flag function in here, flag query. And when we generate the code by using GQL again, it will generate this tab. So it will have a function named flag, and then it will have start time, end time, and the number of element that you want to retrieve. But it will be left as a panic not implemented. So you really need to implement this function. When we want to get the data from the flag service, because we are using gRPC, we only need to call the gRPC function from this method. So what we do is we call r.flagService.issued, and then we specify the profile ID. And we got the data and the error, if any. But the problem that I mentioned earlier is we want to secure the data. So it means we really need to have access control lists in our system. And that's the only way that we can protect the data for every query handler. As you can see here, for the query handler flag, for every time someone is calling this, we are going to check the permission, whether the user that's calling this function has specific permission. If it has, and then we will go to call the flag service. Otherwise, it will return error. But if you see here, if someone already has the access to flag handler, which means they will have access to all of the data returned by the query handler, right? And we don't want to that. We want to protect every field inside flag data. So what if every field within flag has its own permission? Should we use if else in every data? So we check whether booking ID, they have permission for booking ID or not, or they have permission for booking at, issued at, and so on. And we don't want to do that because it's going to make the code really bad. So there is a cool stuff from GraphQL called directive. So in here, you can specify a directive that you can use. In this situation, I create a directive called has permission, and then it will accept one parameter, which is the enum of permission. In this situation, the sample of permission is arrival, departure, booking meta, flag issuance, and so on. And how I use it in the GraphQL schema. So this is our previous schema. This is the customer, which has flag query. And then we only need to specify at has permission with a specific permission. In this situation, it might be flag issuance. And if you want to protect the other fields within the flag, you need to give a permission for has permission to a specific field. In this situation, booking ID will have no permission, so you can access it without having any permission, but flag issuance permission in here. So that's the idea. And how it relates to Go. After you create this directive, surely you need to implement the has permission. So when you generate the code, GKL again will have a config. Within that config, it has a property called directive, and it has a function within that directive. So what you need to do is you have to pass a function of this. It accepts context, object, and the next. It works like middleware, and also it gives you information about the permission. So what you can do inside this function is basically check whether the user that is calling your API has the given permission or not. If it has, it will call the next method. Otherwise, it will return error. So this is the way how you can protect every field within the object in GraphQL. And how we inject this permission to the users? This is the answer. So we have authorization middleware, authentication middleware. So what it really does here before we really process the data to the GraphQL handler, what we do is we call a function that basically will return all of the permission that a user has. So in this situation, I call permission DAO and dot get permission and given a client ID, which define what user that is trying to access the data. And once I get it, maybe I can cache it so that I don't really need to call the service every time. So and after that, after I have the permission, I store it within the Go context by using a with value, context.with value, and I give the alt context, and then I give a key, and then put all of the permission in here. By using this way, this get current user, take the current user from this context, will have all of the permission necessary for checking this permission. And after that, yeah, it's simple as you call the next HTTP handler, like what you really usually do in HTTP, in handling HTTP requests. And then this is how you define the endpoint. So GraphQL only has one endpoint, which is less query. I need to wait until this. Okay. So you can see here, we have http.handler given endpoint, which is query, and then I call the middleware in here, and after that, I pass it the next GraphQL handler that provided by the GKL again. And after that, I don't really need to call the gRPC service for checking permission because it has been handled in some other places. So in the flight handler, I just need to call the gRPC service for returning the flight issuance data. And if I want, I can do some processing, and then I return the process data to back to the users. That's all. So what's the lesson learned? This is maybe all of you already familiar with this type of problem, but because we are quite new with Golang, we don't really realize it until it breaks our production. So the problem is don't reuse Golang context for multiple downstream calls in GraphQL. Create a new one instead. Why? Because when you reuse the same context, basically when, let's say, for this situation, we only call flight handler. But what if at the same time we call flight handler, hotel handler, train handler, and everything, and we use the same context? If one of these handler cancel the context or maybe return timeout for that context, all of the other services will get impacted. And we don't want to do that. Because maybe you don't know this, but in GraphQL, you can return the data and the error at the same time. So let's say I have three calls to the handler. The first one, flight, hotel, and train. But train returns error. But I still be able to get the data from flight and hotel. So that's the cool thing about GraphQL. Even though it's error, you still get the data. And then you also get information about why the call to the train is failing. And this is how we do it. Every time we are going to pass, every time we are going to call the next gRPC service, we create a new context and use that context to the gRPC call in like this. Context with timeout or context with cancel, and it's up to you, you name it. And then we pass the context to the flag service.issued. That's the first lesson learned. The second one, this is something wrong with the library, in my opinion. Adding new schema to GQL again is quite hassle. Why? First time you generate the GraphQL schema, it will generate all of the empty stuff that you need to implement. Okay, let's say the name is GraphQL.go. After that, you got a new feature and you have to add more schema to the GraphQL schema. And the bad thing is it will not add new stuff to the old resolver that you have. So what you have to do, you have to take the copy of the old generated code, put it somewhere else, and then regenerate it so that you get all of the handler. And then you just pick the new one. Pick the new one and move it to the copied generated code and then put it back. So that's the thing that we don't really like, because every time we add new schema, we have to do these things over and over again. And I think this is a chance or opportunities to contribute to this project. I don't know if you're interested. Maybe you are. And I think that's all. Thank you. I hope you enjoyed the talk, and I hope after this you know something more about GraphQL and want to try it at home or even at your office. That's all. Thank you. Okay.